Iran, the United States, and its Western allies will meet again for direct negotiations over its nuclear program later this month. Next week, IAEA inspectors are expected to visit Iran's newly disclosed nuclear enrichment facility. Inside Iran, there are continued reports of government repression in the aftermath of the disputed June elections. President Ahmadinejad has closed down newspapers, and three protesters who participated in the post-election demonstrations have been sentenced to death. Joining me now is Roger Cohen. He writes the Globalist column for the New York Times and the International Herald Tribune. He was in Iran during the election and the violence that followed. I am pleased to have him here at this table. Tell me how you see the dilemma for Israel as a country today, looking at its best interest and its future.
Well, Israel's a small country surrounded by enemies, some of which talk openly about Israel's destruction. And so you have to get inside the Israeli psyche and understand that. However, Charlie, when I listened to Prime Minister Netanyahu at the UN last month, the first half of the speech was about the Holocaust, about the Nazis, comparing Iran to the Nazi regime. And my feeling is that Israel lives in a changing Middle East. There are threats to it, but let's try to be sober about this. Let's look at Hamas, look at Hezbollah, look at Iran, and see if we can take the rhetoric down a notch or two, and let's set aside these, I think, very misleading comparisons and analogies with the Holocaust, and deal, for example, with an Iranian regime that is erratic and sometimes ruthless, but has also proved over the last 30 years that it can be pragmatic and prudent. Indeed, that's one reason it survived.
Meridor says all they need is a bargaining partner on the other side because they know that the demographic thing is coming down on them and they don't have much choice.
But then at the same time, you have Foreign Minister Lieberman saying the other day that he doesn't see any prospect of a settlement for years to come, and there is no opportunity for that. And you have Israel saying that Hamas is an interlocutor with whom it cannot speak. Now, the Hamas Charter calls for the destruction of Israel, so you can see the problem there. But I say,
so what's the problem for Israel? Do they say, look, well, these people don't want to recognize our right to exist. They want to, you know, remove us from the face of the earth, so therefore, let's hunker down.
Yeah, but Israel has proceeded in a very pragmatic way since 1948. It's acted in a de facto manner. If Hamas is ready to talk, and there are lots of different strands to Hamas, if Hamas is ready to talk, what is the problem? What is the harm in trying that avenue? Because I think it's in Israel's interest to try and see a more united Palestinian interlocutor. And you're not going to do that so long as you say that Hamas is simply untouchable.
Yeah, but see,
I think over time, Hamas can be coaxed to change, especially with a very pragmatic president like President Obama. He can help, as can the special envoy, George Mitchell. But we have to, I think, take some rhetorical clutter out of our minds and just look in a hard-nosed way at the realities on the ground and see if we can move this forward.
Okay, but I mean, yeah. Here's... We all know that the Arab countries say one thing in public and then say different things in private.
We do.
And maybe every government does that.
Yeah.
But having said that about the Arab countries and the surrounding countries of Israel, it is also true that the Israelis say one thing in public and at the same time they're looking for 1,000 back channels.
Mm-hmm.
I guarantee you they are using the good offices of Israel to try to talk to and send signals to Hamas.
Yeah, I'm sure they probably are. But at the same time, I see it, for example, with the recent report from Justice Goldstone on the Israeli military operation in Gaza, what accusing both Palestinians, suggesting that both Palestinians and Israel may have been guilty of war crimes. What is the Israeli response? It is immediately to say, no, absolutely not. It's not possible. This is biased. This is unreasonable.
Right,
this is unacceptable.
Right.
And I think if we can just, you know, set all
so
that...
So how should they handle
Israel
that?
Should think of itself as a... You know, all ordinary countries make mistakes, have failings, and Israel recognizes its own right to self-defense, but it often seems that it doesn't see the Palestinian right to self-defense. If a house in Gaza is demolished, that's a fair attack on terrorists.
If they destroy a house in Gaza, they call it an act of self-defense.
An act of self-defense. But if a Palestinian who happens to live in that house throws a stone at the guys conducting
terrorism.
That attack, that's terrorism. So I think we've got to... Let's just take it down a notch.
What do you think their instinct will be with respect to Iran if no progress has been made by the end of the year?
Well, that's the million-dollar question, Charlie. Will Israel, if it sees no diplomatic progress, would it indeed contemplate and even carry out a military attack on Iran, especially with an Obama administration which, through Defense Secretary Gates and the President himself, have made clear that this administration does not want war in Iran.
And Secretary Gates is saying an attack will only delay it for several years.
Yeah, only delay it several years. And what will be left of President Obama's outreach to the Muslim world if we find ourselves at war from the western border of Iraq, across Arab Iraq, through Persia, all the way to the eastern border of Afghanistan? Because who in the Muslim world, were Israel to attack Iran, is going to distinguish between Israel and the United States? Almost nobody. This would be seen as a combined Israeli-U.S. operation. So my own view is that it would be disastrous, and I think it would be disastrous also for Israel. Israel, as I said, is a small country. It's at war with the Arabs. Does it want to be at war with Persia too? I don't think that if the administration makes clear to Israel that it opposes this and there is still some sort of diplomatic avenue going, that Israel would do this. Some people disagree with me. They think, they point to what Israel has done in the past in Iraq and in Syria, and say that Israel would go ahead. I myself don't think so.
Some say also that sanctions will not work. And this whole dialogue, and I may be talking about you, I may have read this where you wrote this.
Yeah, I'm among those people.
Explain the argument.
Well, I've spent a lot of time in Iran this year, and my head's been in Iran. And one thing you realize in Iran is that this is a sophisticated country that is inured to sanctions. They've been living with sanctions for years. And sanctions for the Iranians amount to a surtax. The goods come in through Dubai. There are very sophisticated channels, and that's what sanctions amount to. In fact, sanctions benefit the Revolutionary Guards because they control this traffic, and it enriches them. So I don't think, from our political and strategic viewpoint, that makes much sense. In addition,
so no amount of economic pressure? Or, I mean, are you saying all economic pressure will fail if its intent is to change behavior?
That's correct, Charlie. I don't think if we want Iran to stop its nuclear program, I don't think we can achieve that through economic sanctions, partly for the reason I just gave, partly also because Russia and China, what have they done in the last decade? They've hugely developed their trade with Iran, and Iran, with its gas and oil supplies, is a very attractive commercial partner for them. And they are not, in my view, going to pay more than lip service to sanctions. So I don't see sanctions being effective. So people then say, well, what's our leverage? And I would answer that our leverage is the current state of Iranian society. After the June 12 election, this government is relatively weak and relatively isolated. And whoever brought home the prize, the elusive prize, of a normalization with the United States would do an awful lot to shore up his popularity in Iran. And I think the very restiveness of Iranian society today, the fact that oil, while it's going up, is still at half the price of a couple of years ago, and Iran has major economic problems, I think all this is causing the regime to look more seriously at the outreach of President Obama than it's looked at any American outreach.
In other words, Iran is saying, maybe we don't need this nuclear weaponry?
I think there's always been an ambiguity there, Charlie. And, of course, Iran's not the first to introduce nuclear ambiguity in the Middle East. If you look at Pakistan, they went from zero to a bomb in 10 years. Iran's been messing around with this for about 40 years now.
Because the Shah wanted it from
the
us.
The Shah wanted it, and there have been pushes, and then they pull back.
Yeah.
And look, what's the alpha and omega of the Iranian regime? The alpha and omega of the Iranian regime is survival. They know that if they make a bomb, let alone threaten Israel with that bomb, or provide that bomb to somebody who would threaten Israel, the survival prospects of the Islamic Republic are zero. And the chances of Iran not being pretty quickly reduced to an ashtray or something resembling it are also remote. So I don't... And what is the consensus of U.S. intelligence right now? It is that weaponization efforts are on hold. So there is a hesitation there. Does Iran want to put itself close?
Don't let that go past. The consensus of American intelligence is that weaponization is on hold.
What does weaponization mean in your case? They are not working on building a warhead so that they could have a deliverable nuclear weapon. They are producing low-enriched uranium, which could, in theory, be turned into highly enriched uranium, which could make a bomb. They, to our knowledge, have not taken that additional step. Now, can we have 100% certainty that there aren't clandestine programs going on? No.
What do you think is going on internally?
Well, the tumult has died down. My inner tumult after emerging from Iran has died down some. It took a while.
Your inner tumult, meaning it really had an effect on you?
Huge. Tell me about it. It was one of those moments when it's just a privilege to be a journalist, and it was uplifting and quite devastating. And it's been a very tough call for me, whether there are a lot of people saying, well, now there's an opposition, you know, we should be supporting the opposition, we should not talk to this government, this government's illegitimate. And you know my feelings about the election, but I still feel, I then ask myself, well, if we follow that path, where are we? We're kind of back to Bush. You know, we've cut off relations. Iran is part of some evil axis again, and we're going nowhere. And I just feel that in the long run, if we can break through the American-Iranian psychosis, that will help the people who want a freer Iran.
The American-Iranian psychosis?
Yeah. Then we are helping the people who want a freer Iran, a more open Iran, an Iran more in touch with the world. So in the long term, difficult as it is to pursue engagement right now, it's the right course, because that ultimately will lead, if it works, I think, to an Iran that's more open and more democratic.
Okay, but how do we do it? I mean, that's the question. I mean, how do you both have a relationship and encourage?
I think it's a very hard path to tread, Charlie.
I know, exactly. In other words, I don't know how to do it. I've had nobody sit at this table and tell me how to do it.
Well, I don't know what Bill Burns is staying privately in his conversations with his Iranian counterpart, but I hope that at some point in all this we are raising our concerns, as Hillary Clinton just did in Russia. We are raising our concerns over this clampdown, over the arrest, the suppression of human rights, and I think we have to keep that conversation open. And if we can get a bilateral dialogue going, that's one of the issues that we should discuss. But there are so many issues on the table between the U.S. and Iran that it's essential that we can't do it all in the multilateral framework. It has to, you know, we've been, had these hang-ups for, you know, since the U.S. involvement in the Mossadegh coup in
isn't this interesting? Here you are saying what, I mean, the whole argument against the Bush administration was you don't believe in multilateralism.
Yeah.
And you know where I'm going. Yeah. The big argument that Obama said, look, we're in this together and we've got to work together. And yet you're saying, and others are saying, talk to the North Koreans, make it bilateral. Talk to the Iranians, make it bilateral. I mean, go figure.
Yeah, I'm not saying the multilateral track on the nuclear issue should be disbanded. I'm just saying it's inadequate. We've got to complement it with the kinds of bilateral talks where we can put everything out there. You know, there's a lot to talk about. We need to talk about Hamas.
Right.
Need to talk about Hezbollah. Getting back to Israel, we need to talk about Israel, Afghanistan, Iraq. So many issues.
Mm-hmm. So we don't know how to align ourselves with the revolutionary, with the reform forces in Iran, and at the same time try to have some engagement that will lead to something better with the existing regime.
My point is that in the long term, imagine if there were a U.S. embassy in Tehran and there were an Iranian embassy in Washington. Iran will be a different place, and the Islamic Republic, in my view, will still be there. But for those who are in the reformist movement and those who so bravely went out and were beaten before my eyes in June, I think that over the medium term, that, because these people, 65% of Iranians are under 35. We want them to live in a more normal Iran. And a more normal Iran has to be an Iran that has gotten out from under saying death to America every Friday.
Mm. Yeah, they don't say that anymore. Actually, I don't think I'm told that they don't say America, death to America. They say death to, you know, a lot of other people now.
Yeah, well, the protesters have been saying, you know, the
Death to the dictator.
And death to Russia, yeah. Because of Russian support for Ahmadinejad.
Although Ahmadinejad's speeches
haven't changed. Look, what happened after the election was unconscionable, Charlie. And it's tough to say we've got to talk to these guys, but I believe we do, because I don't see a viable alternative.
When you look at Karoubi, for example, and Mousavi, you think that regime will put them in jail?
Is it yes
for one and not for the other?
Yeah, possibly Karoubi, who's been very brave.
Because he talks about rape in the prison, which is...
Yes, he has spoken very bravely.
He puts a very strong finger in their eye.
Yeah, in fact, some people were talking about him for the Nobel Peace Prize, or Neda Aga Sultan, the young woman who was shot dead.
Do you know what...
I think that... Yeah, sorry.
Ahmadinejad said to me...
What did he say?
They thought that was somehow set up.
Yeah, they've said that to me, too. I mean, the Iranian mission has said that to me, too. And what do I say to them? Okay, you believe that. What should you do? Not throw 500 journalists out of the country, not throw me out of the country, not keep anybody from going there. Say, call a press conference or call me in or somebody and say, okay, here's the ammunition that was used. Here's the ammunition that we and the security forces use. You know, here is the evidence we have. And on this basis, we say the following. Mm. But that's not what happened,
I know.
And similarly, when they say, you know, the election
number... I'm surprised
that
they would argue that. I mean, I just thought it was stunning to
argue that. Yeah, it is stunning. And the same way they say, you know, you're wrong about the election numbers. Ahmadinejad won fair and square. You don't know what went on in the provinces. I said, well, take us to the villages. Mm-hmm. Take us to the towns. Let us do our work. You know, prove your point. But that's not what happened. Now, Mousavi to jail... Yeah, I mean, I think they're trying to avoid that because that would be a galvanizing factor for the opposition. And indeed, Iran was on a razor's edge, Charlie. When those 3 million
could have toppled.
Yeah, when those 3 million people were in the street on the Monday, I thought about this often. I saw Mousavi, and if he's been brave in many ways, but look, if he'd said, "Here I am, I stand and fall with my supporters. This will not pass." We don't know what would have happened.
I suppose he'd been Yeltsin.
Yeah, I mean, we, you know, sometimes history really, the hinge of history is, it's a very slight thing, and it could have gone a different way. I don't know which way exactly, but I think Mousavi, in the crunch, like Hatami before him, another reformist figure, he didn't quite rise to it.
Yeah, one of Hatami's principal lieutenants is in prison.
Yes. There are a lot of... the Newsweek stringer is still in prison. And a lot of the people I spoke to when I first got there are still in jail.
All right. Afghanistan.
Yeah.
The president's got a big decision coming up, and everybody says it's the most important decision he'll make in his presidency. What are his options? Seriously, options.
Well, you know, frankly, Charlie, I haven't written about this because I'm agonizing like the president about...
Are you really? As to what he ought to do?
As to what he ought to do,
How will you go about informing your decision?
Well, on the one hand, Afghanistan is poor, weak. It will never, in the foreseeable future, have a strong central government. So what are we really trying to achieve there? On the other, I don't really buy the argument that some are trying to make now that, you know, Taliban's really okay and Al-Qaeda's are the bad guys and we could kind of let the Taliban come back and that wouldn't necessarily...
I get a lot of people who come here and say that. Don't buy that.
Yeah, and my hunch is that McChrystal, who's on the ground and, you know, whose report is a brilliant report, that we should give him the means to try and do what he wants to do. But... as my colleague Tom Friedman pointed out in a recent column, we don't know now if it'll be a Karzai government or not. It seems the election has been thrown open again, and that's partly why I think the president is going slowly. But if it is a Karzai government, he has to deliver. He has to deliver on less corruption. He has to deliver on serious governors. I saw a British general in Europe recently, and he said, we have to go to Karzai with a contract. And the contract is to deliver those things I just mentioned. And we have to say to him, either it's your signature on this contract or your brains. And I think what he means by that is that if we leave, Karzai's not going to survive. And so it's in Karzai's interest, President Karzai's interest, to begin delivering on the things he hasn't delivered on.
On that, thank you for coming.
Thank you, Chuck.
Roger Cohen, who impressed all of us with his coverage in Iran and courage he showed in reflecting the courage of all those people who